everyone, and welcome to a new video. Today's video is going to be the first installment in Progress Logmas. And if you have no idea what that is, it's kind of a play on Vlogmas, which you might be familiar with if you follow other channels on YouTube. Vlogmas is where creators vlog every day leading up until Christmas and try and post those videos daily as well. Now, I can't quite commit to that. I don't think my days are interesting enough to devote a single video to each one, but I am going to try and vlog what I get up to throughout the weeks leading up until Christmas and compile them into as many 20-minute long vlogs as they possibly can. Even though the title of this is a play on Progress Log Christmas, mine aren't going to be super festive in nature. They're mostly going to be about my day-to-day sewing activities as I try and complete a half dozen costumes before the end of December. That being said, this first installment is going to have some holiday spirit to it, just because I want to put up my Christmas tree today, and I also recently went to Michael's and picked up some seasonal decor. I'd like to do a haul and then put up my tree, and then show you around my sewing room, and then we can get into actual sewing. But first I have some cleaning to do because I've been rearranging my sewing room and trying to improve my filming setup, which involves setting up various tripods and lighting equipment and moving stuff around. So it's a disaster in here. So I really need to get it tidied, and then maybe I can put my tree up and then I have another video to film, and then we'll just see where this week slash video takes us. So this is the current situation. There's just kind of stuff everywhere. There's like rewards for Patreon over there, my dog's bed because I didn't want it on the floor because I didn't want to risk dropping pins on it. I've got a bunch of new camera equipment since I'm upgrading my setup. And then over here is kind of sparse because this is where I was reorganizing a lot of stuff. And then I have more camera equipment and my Christmas decorations. So there's definitely quite a bit of work that has to be done in here before I can move forward with anything else today. So the tree is now up. This is just a pre-lit tree that I purchased from Michael's, probably 3 or 4 years ago for $20. And it has rainbow lights. And previous years I've used a lot of red and gold baubles on it, and I really liked how it turns out. But this year I want to match my sewing room a little bit better. So I purchased some silver and blue garlands, and then I ended up ordering some pink baubles online because I couldn't find any in stores. So it's going to be a pink and a teal tree this year. Also, I cleaned my sewing room so it looks much tidier in here, except I just put the pile of stuff that I purchased from Michael's on the table, and now I'm gonna do a little haul. So it's looking a little less tidy than it was 10 minutes ago. So these weren't purchased on my most recent trip to Michael's, but they are from Michael's, and they're glittery plastic dinosaurs. So I have pink ones, I have green ones, and then I have these blue and purple ones. So these are all gonna go on the tree this year. And then I think the rest of my ornaments and stuff are at the bottom, so I'll show you what else I got at Michael's first. I got stuff for two different headpieces. It's been a couple years since I've made a holiday headpiece, but they used to be a staple on my channel. I'd like to bring it back this year. So I got enough stuff for two headpieces and then some because I bought quite a lot. Lastly, from the floral department, I picked up some red stuff. I'm not sure if red is going to be incorporated in my Christmas project this year, but I really liked the shade of red. These are like a very deep wine reddish burgundy. I got some organizers while I was there. I will try and link these down below. These are bead landing 10-inch by 7-inch plastic organizers, and I use these to store buttons, and I recently purchased a lot more buttons, so I need something to store them in, so I picked up two of these. This is a whole bunch of stuff for Patreon. I got a set of envelopes and flat cards just so I can write little notes, and then I purchased some gift tags that I thought were really, really cute, and then I got these holiday cards that have glitter on them and unicorns and Christmas trees and presents, and I just thought these would be adorable for little notes to patrons as well. Now, I really wanted my Christmas tree to be teal and pink because those are the colors of my sewing room, but I had the worst time trying to find pink Christmas decorations in both Michael's and Joann's. So I ended up ordering those ornaments online, but I also purchased some pink ribbon that I can try and incorporate into the tree to hopefully make it a little bit less blue. Speaking of blue slash teal, this is what motivated the color theme change of the tree. I found this sparkly garland at Michael's and it was $10, and then it was 50% off, so it was $5. And I thought this matched my sewing room perfectly and would look absolutely gorgeous around the tree. I've never had a tree with like tinsel garlands on it before. We just don't do it in my household. I've never had a tree with ribbon on it before or anything. So I thought it might be kind of fun to make my tinsely garland Christmas tree dreams come true this year. I got one of those, and then I got two of these garlands, which are made out of like 1-inch plastic balls. And then they've got sparkly balls between them and tinsel. And I purchased some blue and white ornaments. I don't know how many of these I'm going to use because I really want to leave room for the pink ones. But again, we'll see what I can do. From Michael's, I got a star tree topper. I've never had a tree with a star at the top of it either. We're very much in like angel at the top of the tree family. And I think the angels are really pretty, but they didn't have any that really fit the scale of my tree. So I thought I would go ahead and get this little star instead. And then I got some white Christmas tree lights just because I didn't think the rainbow would work really well with the silver and blue garlands. And they actually had this hidden behind two displays of LED colorful lights. So I really had to go digging for it, but I did end up finding it. And then lastly, I have a pile of unicorns. So I feel like Joann's and Michael's have both really upped their game with ornaments this year. There are so many pretty ones. But of course, the ones I gravitated towards were the unicorns, and these are actually made out of foam, and then they've got flocked material over top of them. And they've got little, like, fuzzy manes, and their horn and their hooves and their nose are gold. So I thought these were really cute, and I got as many as they had, which was 5. So hopefully that stuff, paired with the decorations that I already have, can make a beautiful tree. I don't have a whole lot of time left to decorate, but let's just get started and see if I can at least get the lights and the garlands on. Okay, I love my Christmas tree every year, but this year I love it extra hard. I mean, it looks so cute with the unicorns and the dinosaurs, and I ended up using some of my green and fuchsia colored sparkly ornaments as well, like this one. I do want to incorporate a little bit more pink into this, so I'm excited for those ornaments to arrive, and I actually didn't even end up using any of these. So it is now much later in the day. I have eaten large quantities of Thanksgiving dinner and pie and cheesecake, and I feel a little sick, but I'm back up into work because I made a list of things that I have to get done before December 24th and also things I need to get done before January 8th. Those are my two deadlines. One is self-imposed with holiday themed costumes, and the other one is imposed by McCall's, so it's very important. And I realized that there are 22 garments that I would like to make over the 1 month period ahead of us, or 5 week period ahead of us. So I decided to come back up and get some work done, and I've also made a list of things I need to get done over the next 2 days. I'm making this pair of stays to wear underneath a 1720s inspired riding habit, and none of the stays in my foundation wardrobe are long line enough to be appropriate for that period when a very low-waisted kind of conical silhouette was popular. So I copied a pattern out of Nora Waugh's corsets and crinolines, which I will link down below, and I just altered it to fit me better, and I did all of the fittings over my existing set of stays, but I decided to cut the tabs about a half inch or 3/4 inch lower than where the tabs on my current set of stays are. So it should have the appearance of a much lower waist when it is worn. So for this, I'm using a layer of cotton and then 2 layers of canvas or inner lining canvas. It's very lightweight but very durable canvas. So there's 1 layer of super lightweight, then there's a layer of medium weight, and then there's the top layer of fabric, which is a premium sparkle cotton that I purchased from Joann's. The boning channels on the original pattern, or the pattern that I made, it's not like an original historic stays pattern. And because the canvas is so lightweight, I could just place it over top my pattern and see the channels through the fabric and trace them all onto the material. And then I pinned the lightweight canvas to the medium canvas and the medium canvas to the fashion layer fabric, and then I went ahead and sewed all of the boning channels. And when I do this, instead of cutting all the pieces to the size right off the back, like this one, I just really roughly cut the pieces out and I leave quite a bit of seam on all the edges. So that way I don't have to worry about the edges lining up when I am sewing the boning channels. I just have to worry about my stitches being straight and even. Then after everything is sewn, I can iron it and then cut it out properly and end up with a really nice piece looking like this. And on top of not having to worry about the edges becoming misaligned during the process, you also don't have to worry about the edges fraying during the process when you're really manipulating the material a lot. This is especially nice if you're making stays out of a brocade or a silk or something that's more prone to fraying. So I'm going to go ahead and cut the rest of the pieces out and get all of the threads trimmed, and then I can start on assembly.
Not off to the best start with this video because I didn't film anything yesterday. Yesterday was actually not a great day. It was Black Friday, so my mom and I ended up going out to Michael's and Joann's as well as an antique store. I picked up a couple things at each shop, including some Christmas ornaments for my tree. I got some pink ornaments from the antique store that came in this really cool vintage box. So those are now on my tree, as well as some more unicorn ornaments and some more sparkly dinosaurs because both Joann's and Michael's had those in stock. So my tree is looking very cute, but unfortunately the rest of yesterday was not particularly cute. I forgot to take my medication, so midday I was absolutely exhausted, and by then it was too late to take my medication, so I just got progressively more and more tired as the day passed, and I felt like I was on the verge of an anxiety attack, and it really, really sucked. So I'm sorry that I didn't film anything yesterday, but it was because I didn't get anything done yesterday, which is very unfortunate considering that I have this super long list that was supposed to be done yesterday, and I was going to make a new list for today, but now I need to focus on everything I didn't get done yesterday. So I managed to cross a couple things off, but there's still a ton left to do, so let's just keep our fingers crossed that I can manage to get it done. I've already gone through and signed all of the prints I need to send out for patrons this month. Now I need to address the envelopes and then get those packaged up, so they're ready to go out tomorrow. I also want to get that set of stays finished today, and I also have two videos to film for Patreon, so it's gonna be busy, and I'm just gonna do my best to get it all done.
The stays are looking so far. I think last time I showed you them, I had just sewn all the boning channels. So after sewing all the boning channels, I ironed the pieces, and then I trimmed around the edges, and then I sewed the pieces together, and these were sewed together with a 1/2 inch seam allowance. My binding is just 1 inch strips of the same fabric that were cut on the bias of the fabric, which is a diagonal grain line, which gives the binding a little bit of natural stretch, which makes it easier, though still not easy, to ease around curves. And then I folded one edge inward by 1/4 inch, and I sewed the other edge on to the stays with the right sides facing each other and a 1/4 inch allowance. I did it all by machine, and I didn't use any pins because that's what Red Threaded says to do, and she is like a stays expert. And then I folded the other edge inward and top stitched it down, again trying to keep stuff even, not using pins, working very slowly. It didn't turn out the best. As you can see, instead of stitching in the ditch, so just past the point of the bias binding that's visible from the front, at some points I actually stitched over the binding. But overall, I think they look pretty good. I don't have a ton of puckering around the top points, so I'm happy with that. So the next step is just going to be adding all of the boning to this, which is going to take forever, but I've got a good podcast to listen to, so it shouldn't be too miserable. And for boning, I'm going to be using something called plastic whalebone, also just known as plastic boning, which does a good job of mimicking whalebone, as well as reed, which would have been traditionally used in stays from this period. And when I say reeds, I do mean reeds, like plant matter. And you can still buy reed today to use, but the problem with it is that it's prone to breaking or snapping, so the stays don't tend to last as long, and you also have to be a little bit more delicate with them. So I prefer using the plastic alternative. There are many options out there for you in your stay making adventures, and I'll try and link some of them down below. So once again, it's been a while since I filmed. I actually spent all of yesterday filming. I was filming a video about organizing my button collection, and I had a lot of fun doing that, and I had a lot of fun filming that, so that'll get its own devoted video coming up soon. And then I spent 4 hours last night preparing all of these envelopes. So these are for my $16 tier on Patreon, so each one includes 2 signed postcard prints. So I had to sign the prints, and then I had to address all of the envelope and stuff the envelopes and tape the envelopes closed and attach little stickers and stamp them, and now they are ready to go. And then all of these are for my top tier patrons, so my $36 patrons. So I'm a little late this month, so I'm sending out the ones for October and the ones for November at the same time. So for October, I have prints of my Halloween project, I have swatch cards relating to them, and then I have a little note and a pattern for the pumpkin hat. And then for November, since the rewards go out in December, it's kind of Christmas themed, I have little presents that I wrapped up, and then I have swatch cards for last year's Christmas project along with the prints of it, and another little note. So I had to write all of the notes this morning, and then wrap some stuff, and then make the swatch cards, and then make 9 copies of a pattern. So I thought it was gonna take me like 2 hours to get everything done, and it ended up taking me 4 or 3.5, I guess. So I thought I was gonna be done by 10:30, and now it's almost noon. So all I've had to eat today is 5 Oreo cookies, or 5 gluten-free equivalents of Oreo cookies, because I thought that'd be faster than eating breakfast, and that I might be able to put this out so the mail lady could pick it up. Somewhat literally missed the boat. So I'm gonna have to take a drive over to the post office, and then I will eat lunch, and then I will figure out what I'm doing today. This little one down here has a vet appointment this afternoon. I'm kind of stressed about it. So I don't know if I'm going to start filming one of the Christmas costume making up videos today, or if I'm just going to do some hand sewing and some editing. Hopefully I've included a really long, very satisfying time lapse of this process. So I didn't end up filming anything yesterday either. I think that's kind of going to be the theme of this week, just because I'm trying to get the making up videos about both my Christmas costumes done the first week of December, so that I won't be as pressured in terms of editing as we approach Christmas. I kind of have 3 Christmas costumes this year. I have 2 that I'm filming making up style videos for, and then I've got one that I'd like to make in my off time. And the one I'd like to make in my off time is a 1720s riding habit. So I'm currently still working on the foundations to go underneath it, and then I can start draping and drafting the dress that goes on top of it. the trim for it actually arrived yesterday, and it's gorgeous, which I'm very grateful for because it was very expensive. Not per yard, but buying 30 yards of it was pretty pricey, so I'm glad that I love it even more in person. It's so, like, sparkly, but also looks quite vintage because it's an embroidered base over mesh, and I just love it. But I can't even think about that yet because, as I said, I'm focusing on the projects that I'm filming. So in here I have a 1620/1630 dress, or the beginnings of it. And then here I have the fabrics that will be for Regency dress. So my goal for today is to get both bodices to a point where I can try them on so I can draft the sleeves, because I haven't done that yet because my mock-ups both needed not major alterations, but enough alterations where they were no longer an accurate depiction of how the finished garment would fit. So I wanted to wait until I actually had the finished garments before drafting the sleeves. So that's kind of my tentative goal for today, and this is what I managed to accomplish yesterday. I also got the lacing panels assembled, and then I sewed a whole bunch of eyelets off screen while I was watching Pole Dark. I actually sewed a bunch of eyelets for the stays I mentioned earlier as well, but I saved four of them to do on camera. And then this is the rest of the bodice. So it is lined with cotton, and then it has a base layer of canvas and an outer layer that's actually two layers of satin. And the reason I used two layers of satin is because the boning was kind of showing through the first layer of satin, so I decided that layer would be basically a cushion, and then I'd put another layer of decorative satin on top. So that's what I did, and I'm pretty happy with this so far, but it's not at a point where I can try it on, so I don't really know how well it's going until I get to that point. And then this is the stomacher for it, and then these are the lacing panels that go underneath the stomacher. So to get this to a point where I can try it on and fit the sleeves, I have to get the lacing panels finished and get those sewn in, and also I should really finish the interior, so I should finish these edges. And then I basically have everything to do on the Regency bodice because I haven't even started that. They do have the pattern for it finished. Also, last night I went through and I've been commissioned to make some hats, specifically these four hats, and three of them are based off of hats I've made before, and then this one is new guy. So I just went through and collected the hats that I'm going to be using as a base. I don't have the original patterns for any of these hats, so I have to draft the patterns based off of the existing hats, and then I also collected all of the materials for them, so I kind of know what I'm getting into, and that's all in one place for when I have time to work on it. So I think this is what I'm going to do in the evening for the next couple of days, and then these are what I'm going to be working on in the daytime when the daylight's good. And yeah, it's gonna be a busy couple of days. I'm gonna try and document it as best I can, but when I'm filming making up videos all day, I'm not really sure what else to film for the vlog because it's all just content you're gonna see in more detail at some point anyway. But I can show you my new filming setup. Look, I have an overhead view here now, and I have a monopod which sits on top of this tripod when it's at its lowest level, so it doesn't take up nearly as much room, but I had to steal the ball joint from the monopod for these mounts because the mount that I bought that attaches to this pole only holds the camera in one direction, whereas the ball jointed mount gives me more flexibility, quite literally. So I had to steal the ball joints from my monopod, which means that I have to use this in its fully extended glory, which makes it take up way more floor space, which I'm not happy about, but working with what I have until Amazon blesses me with the delivery and I have more ball head tripod mount things. I'm not a photographer. I have no idea what any of this is called. It took me like longer than it should have to figure out how to set this up. And this is a little bit questionable. Look at the legs of the tripod. I originally bought a C-stand, like a very expensive proper C-stand that was going to sit on that side and then like the camera would hang over, but the pole had to be extended so long that it was really, really shaky even though the base itself was quite stable. So now I have a really unstable base but a short pole, so it's a lot more like structurally solid. It's probably going to fall down some way and I'm going to hurt myself, but it's working for now, so I'm just going to take that as a win. It's been another productive day. My new mount for my camera arrived. So now I have a tripod that can be at its lowest setting, so it only takes up this much floor space, yet it's tall enough for me to film things that are going on at my table as well as at my sewing machine. So I'm really excited about this. I actually got a fancier tripod mount for it, so I have an easy release to take the camera on and off, whereas these things you have to unscrew and it's a little bit more fiddly. So very pleased with that. I also managed to make some good progress on my 1630s Christmas project. However, I didn't even touch the Regency one because I got this book in the mail today, and it's really changed how I want to approach both the sleeves and the skirt of the dress. So I think tonight I'm going to try and get these sleeves roughly drafted as well as the skirt drafted, and then I can cut out all the pieces tomorrow instead of just cutting out the bodice. That's also going to ensure that I have enough fabric to cut everything out, which I think is a good thing to have in mind. Then down here I just have the three hats that I finished reverse engineering, and in here I have all of the materials for the hats, and over there I have all the interfacing for the hat. I also looked up a whole bunch of references of hats from the 1880s and came up with a more specific design for that. This was just a really kind of rough draft that I was pitching, but I've really fine-tuned it a lot and have come up with something that's historically accurate but still kind of reminiscent of my sketch. All of the patterns that I reversed engineered, I went ahead and wrote instructions on, and I also drafted the pattern for both the base layer as well as the fabric that will go over the base layer. The one that I drafted from scratch, I'm keeping it really simple, and I'm not drafting like the official version of the pattern until I've done a test of it and know it fits and know it has the right shape and feel comfortable moving forward with it. But on that note, I'm going to get all of the base pieces cut out of interfacing. So maybe I will include a time lapse of the tracing and cutting out process of all of these pieces, which you can't see because I put the interfacing over it.
Hello everyone! So it is currently December 5th and it is 10:55 a.m. Last time we talked, I was getting the hat bases cut out for four different hat patterns, and those were originally going to be the bases for the actual completed hats, but I've decided instead that I'm going to use them to make mock-ups. So I'm going to sew all of the wire into them, and then I'm going to sew all the pieces together, and then I will get a really good idea of the form of the hats, but I won't have to invest all of the effort into putting the outer layer fabrics on the panels and lining the panels and adding trims and stuff, only to then find out that things don't match up and that my pattern actually needs changes. So I'm going to use all of those pieces that I cut out as part of mock-ups, and hopefully I'll be able to make major progress on those tonight, and then I can actually get the bases cut out again and I can move forward with the real hats because I really want to get started on those. Also last night, I didn't film it, but I ended up getting two sleeve patterns drafted. This one is based off of a sleeve pattern for a 1660s dress in Janet Arnold's Patterns of Fashion book. It's the first Patterns of Fashion book, but since my dress is from the 1630s, I had to make my panel a lot wider. I had to completely change the gathering placement. I think my pattern's like 4 inches longer, and it's just very, very different. So even though I used her pattern as basis, I wouldn't even consider that like a reference for this pattern because it ended up being so dramatically different. And then I used a pattern from the Regency book that I showed you yesterday as a basis for drafting a Regency sleeve pattern. But again, it got some major, major changes. It no longer really resembles the pattern in that book. But having that sleeve pattern done means that I can move forward with the Regency dress today. I really wanted to work on the 1630s project and get the sleeves kind of done for that, but I haven't plotted out all of the cartridge pleat placement, that's hard to say, on the sleeve pattern, even though the pattern itself is kind of finished. So I can't actually move forward with that without a little bit more invested effort, and I'm not sure if I want to put that effort into it right now, or if I want to work on the Regency project, which is going to be easier, and I'm going to see a lot more progress on for the amount of time and effort I invest into it. It's already almost 11 o'clock, and I have pissed away the first 2 hours of this day. I did come out to work around 9:30 after eating breakfast and everything, and then I became completely invested in researching hair dye, because I had a dream that I had pink hair, and then I woke up and I was thinking about when I used to have purple and red hair, and it really made me miss purple and red hair, especially since I was on a medication earlier this year that made me gain about 15 pounds, and now I'm on a medication that causes hair loss and causes acne, so I'm just not feeling that great about myself, my body right now, and I feel like having purple hair might make things better, so I spent 2 hours looking at various different hair dyes and deciding on various different hair dyes and ordering various different hair dyes and the application tools to use them. So I should probably get to it and figure out what I'm working on and then get to actually working. Also, as a side note, shout out to anyone who has been around here since I had purple hair. You're like an OG original fan. Actually, the people who have been around since my DeviantArt days are the original fans. And then there are the people who have been around since my Tumblr days. And then there are the people who have been around since my purple hair days. But I love you all equally. You're all great. And on that note, I should stop procrastinating and start working.
So it's later in the day now. I ended up working on a mixture of stuff today. So I got the sleeve pattern for the 1630s bodice finalized and cut out. And I actually have one of the sleeves basically completely finished. And I filmed the process of sewing that one. But now tonight, on my off time, I have to finish the other sleeve. And then I have to do the same thing for my Regency dress that I started on today. I also got the skirt partially assembled, and I filmed what I needed to of assembling the skirt. Now I have 3 or 4 more French seams to sew. So there's quite a bit of work to be done involving stuff over there, but I also went ahead and got wire sewn to all of my hat pieces. And as I said earlier, I've decided that these are just going to be hat mock-ups. I'm going to start putting these in piles for specific hats and then start sewing them together. And hopefully everything goes really well so I can finalize the hat patterns and maybe even get the real versions cut up tonight, because I want to get started on those too.
So thanks to the magic of editing, it probably appears like I've been working for approximately 2 minutes, but I've actually been working for 2.5 hours. And I finally finished everything I was supposed to get done last night. So last night I got really invested in my hat mock-ups, which I'll show you later today, so much so that I actually got them all assembled, made all of the pattern alterations, and then went ahead and traced the new finalized pattern pieces onto the interfacing base that I'll be using for the final hat. So because I was so caught up in that, I didn't end up finishing the sleeves that I needed to before I could start filming my making of videos today, and I also didn't sew the remaining seams of the skirt. So this morning I've gone ahead and done that, so now I have 2 sleeves instead of 1, and 2 sleeves instead of 1. So then I spent about half an hour researching shoes because I wanted to get shoes for both these projects that I could alter. I have a whole bunch of Poshmark credits, so I decided I would order through there. So I spent quite a bit of time researching shoes and then trying to find ones in my size that would be vaguely historically accurate after altering. And now it is time to get to good and proper filming. So I'm going to be hopefully adding the cuffs to these sleeves, and I'm going to be sewing the trim around the neckline of the Regency dress. I'd also like to get the sleeves on the Regency dress today, and also mark out and potentially sew on the trim to the skirt, because there's quite a bit of work that I can do on that off camera, so it'd be good to get that done tonight. And then I would actually like to get these sleeves sewn onto the dress as well. I have probably 3 hours of good lighting left, so I'm gonna try and get as much done as I possibly can, and then we can work on hats tonight, which should be fun, because they're actually gonna start coming together because the pattern's done now. And actually, before I do any work, I'm gonna take some Instagram photos of what the Regency bodice looks like in the current state, and then I'm gonna sew the trim onto it, and then take another photo for Instagram, and then hopefully get the sleeves sewn on, and then take another photo for Instagram. They don't really match my feed right now, so they're not gonna be getting posted for a while, but it would be good to have them. I feel like recently on Instagram I kind of like posted a vague progress photo and then like photos of the finished garment, and I'm trying to capture the stages in between a little bit better. So that's what's on the agenda for today, or at least for the upcoming hours, and I'll update you when I'm no longer filming for other videos that you're going to see. So it is currently December 7th, and I'd hoped to have this video up today, but I'm realizing that I haven't done a lot of sewing in this video. Well, I have done a lot of sewing, I just haven't featured any of that sewing because it's going to be featured making of videos, which I kind of knew was going to be the case for this one, and I'm sort of disappointed that this is the video I'm coming back with, because I feel like I'm capable of much better content, and there's much better content coming in the future. I want to get all of the making of video filming done and out of the way at the beginning of the month, so I could focus more on a writing habit that I want to make before Christmas, kind of for the remainder of the month, as well as getting those making of videos edited. So I know this video there hasn't been a lot of sewing content, but there will be in the rest of progress Vlogmas, or at least I hope so. And last night I didn't film much because I was basically trying to finish stuff that I was supposed to do earlier in the day, but I didn't end up getting around to because everything just took much longer than I thought it was going to. I made sleeve bands for my 1630s project sleeves, and then I got those sewn on, and then I got trim sewn onto the Regency bodice, and then I got the Regency sleeves gathered, and now I have about 4 making a video related things I'd like to get done today, and I should probably do those things earlier in the day while the lighting is still good. And those things include setting the Regency sleeves, marking the trim placement on the Regency skirt, and also sewing the ruffles onto the Regency skirt, and then I want to sew the remaining 1630 sleeves on. I sewed one of them on off camera, but now I have to film sewing the final one on. So I think that's probably about 1.5 or 2 hours work, so I should really start on that soon. Then the rest of the day is going to be hat stuff, so hopefully that'll be some interesting content for you guys, because I can film that in more detail since it's not going to pop up in another video later on. I realized I never showed you my hat mock-up, so I thought I would do that now. I just took a photo of them for Instagram, so they're all lined up nice and pretty. Don't mind my super professional weight for the tripod. I was actually using the tripod this camera is on as a stand for this hat. So this is the biggest hat, and it's an Edwardian style hat. It usually is hung up over there, which is why that wall's looking a little empty right now, or at least the hat that inspired this is usually hung up over there, but I took it down so I could reverse engineer it, and this is the mock-up for it. So I'm really happy with this. It's on the larger side,
side, but this is also a hat you would wear with a larger hairstyle. So I think that's appropriate, and that means that it's very much one size fits all, which is great since it's a pretty complicated pattern without getting other sizes involved in it. Or it's not really complicated, there's just a lot of pieces to it. And all of these are made out of 71F interfacing and 19 gauge millinery wire. Then back here I have an 1880s style hat, and it's actually supposed to be worn kind of like that, so then it looks almost like a bonnet because the brim is cut to be much narrower towards the back. But I've actually found that I like how it looks from the side more. I think it's really interesting with the tilt and the brim size. Then over here we have the hat that was originally worn with my 1890s walking ensemble. It originally featured a pheasant pelt on it, but I'm not doing that this time around. I'm going to do a little bit more accessible and a little less disgusting trims on it. This is the hat mock-up that I'm most glad I made because it needed the major alterations. This piece was way too big, so I cut it back pretty substantially. As you can see, the first side got sewn on just fine, but then when I tried to fit the other side, there was like no room for it, so it's all buckly and bad, but we're gonna fix that on the final one. This hat, I actually had some trouble sewing the crown onto the brim, so I ended up adding a half inch to the back here just to give me a little bit more ease, which is extra important since the layers are going to be thicker once I get the fabric on them. This is a slightly smaller hat, but it's also meant to be more fitted, so I think that's good. And it needs a change as well. I've already made the alteration to the pattern, but I had to let it out by 3/4 of an inch. This was a similar situation. I like everything except the crown was too small. It actually fit into the brim, even though I let it out by 3/4 of an inch. Which was kind of a miracle, but I had to make that change on the final pattern. So I'm very, very pleased with these in general, and I'm also quite glad I made a mock-up for all of them just so I could work out those tiny details. Hopefully now making the final versions will go really smoothly. Speaking of the final versions, I already got all of the interfacing pieces cut out for them. I don't think I filmed it this time around because I filmed the process of cutting out the interfacing for the mock-ups, and it was basically identical. And then I just went ahead and sewed the wire into all of these, and I sewed them using the zigzag stitch on my sewing machine. I set it to be as wide as I possibly can. I just try and keep the wire in the middle of the presser foot so I don't have to worry about the needle running over the wire. So I did break 2 needles during this process, which I don't think is that bad considering I was sewing wire into enough pieces for 8 hats. And as you might be able to tell, I was using up bobbins that I had pre-made in a whole bunch of random colors. So there's some variance in the colors used to stitch the wire on, but you're not going to end up seeing it in the end, so I think it's fine. Also, I usually use binder clips to secure the wire on, and then I use pliers to bend the wire, and then I use chin snips to cut the wire. Over here I have these sleeves I was working on for the Regency project. Also here I have the interfacing. So I think I showed this earlier in the video, but it is 71F Playtex, not Playtex, Peltex, ultra firm, one-sided fusible interfacing. You don't actually have to get the fusible type, though it is a little bit stiffer, so I do tend to prefer it, but it's also not as nice to work with because it's scratchier and it can kind of catch on your hands and make them a little bit irritated while you're working. But that's what I'm using for the base of the hats, and then this the wire. This is millinery wire, which means it is steel wire that is coated with thread, so it appears white. Historically, I've been kind of anti-millinery wire, not because I don't like it, but just because I feel like the wire you can buy from a hardware store is just as good, but I will say that the millinery wire seems to have more of a spring steel type property. So it seems to hold its shape better than the hardware store wire. And it's also become a lot more difficult to find the wire at hardware stores that I was using previously. And I found this millinery website that sells 30 yard rolls for I think like $25. It ends up being like $2 worth of wire for a hat, which I don't think is too bad. And it's kind of nice that it's white because then you don't have to line hats that you're making out of lighter colored materials because the gray of the steel wire that isn't coated would show through. So I do like it better, I will say that, but I do think you can get away with using wire from the hardware store and it will turn out just fine. And then here I have the bodice for the Regency project that now has trims sewn on it. I'm really happy with how these trims look together. I purchased these online, so I wasn't sure if they were going to match the fabric or if they were going to have the right scale and proportion, especially when paired together, but I think it looks beautiful. So I'm really, really excited about this project. I'm excited to make some more headway on it today. Though I'm not really looking forward to sewing the sleeves onto the bodice because that's one of my least favorite parts of costumes. I also finished up my stays last night while watching Poldark. I'm on the final season of Poldark, which is very sad because it's one of my favorite shows, but I'm enjoying it very much. Even though I'm kind of getting a lot of the characters confused because they have the same hair color and I'm not paying as much attention as I should be, and the lighting in that show is also very dark, but I'm enjoying it nonetheless. So all the eyelets are sewn on that, and now this means I can try these on, and let's really hope that they fit. And these are going to go underneath my riding habits. So now that these are done, I just have to figure out what the skirt supports are going to be, which is difficult because the skirt silhouette in the 1720s is very different than it was in the mid-1700s, so I'm not really sure if I have anything appropriate for it, and I'm not really sure what was historically appropriate for it because there isn't nearly as much research done in that era, but I'm gonna figure it out. And now let's go back over here where this mess of hat patterns is. So what happened is for some of these hats, I made the full pattern for them. So that includes the pattern for the base as well as the pattern for the fabric that will go over top of the base. And the only difference between those patterns is that the pattern for what's going over top of the base has seam allowances so you can tuck the edges over the base. So for some, like this hat and this hat, I drafted all of the pattern pieces necessary to construct them. But for these two hats, this one especially, since this was my first time making it, I only drafted the base layer pattern. And I have to go through and trace the base layer pattern onto tracing paper and then add seam allowances to it and then cut that out prior to cutting out my fabric to cover the hats, which I would like to do today because they're mainly what I'm planning on working on. So even though this isn't first on my list for today, I think that's what I'm going to do first. That's just kind of what I'm in the mood to do. I might even get all of those pattern pieces cut out this morning before I work on what I'm supposed to work on. Also, I got this book in the mail today and it's absolutely beautiful. I'll link it down below, but it's making me realize how incorrect the fit of the Edwardian project I was working on previously is. And now I kind of want to redo it. I don't have the fabric to redo it and it's very disappointing. But it was supposed to fit like this, it ended up being like skin tight. And though I don't dislike how it looks, I'm realizing that it probably doesn't look the way it's supposed to be historically accurate for this period. But I'm looking forward to having more time to go through this book and gushing over all of the details of these garments because they're gorgeous. Look at those details. I'm getting some serious wardrobe envy. So it's now later in the day and I finished my filming work that I wanted to get done today. So over here I have both sleeves attached to the 1630s bodice. I have the ruffles sewn onto the Regency skirt. I got the sleeves sewn onto the Regency bodice, or at least one of them, which is all I had to film, so I can do the other one at my leisure. And now I'm back to working on hats. So you just saw me cut out all the materials, both the outer fabrics and the lining for the hats. The only things I didn't cut out are the trims for them, so sashes that will go around them once they're finished, as well as the binding that will go around the brims, because I couldn't quite remember what colors I'm using for the binding, so I decided that I'd wait until I'm further along in the construction process to figure that out. But the next step is just going to be ironing the pieces that require it, because I was lazy and didn't do that beforehand. Since these pieces are being wrapped over top of interfacing, they don't have to be cut out perfectly, and I definitely took advantage of that. I was a little bit lazy with it. But now I'm going to iron all of the pieces, and then I'm going to mark the seam allowance onto all the lining pieces. So I'm going to mark probably 1.5 inches away from the edge and then fold the raw edge inward until it reaches that point and iron it down. So all of the edges are folded inward and neatly finished. Then I can just lay it on top of the wrong side of the base pieces and it will cover up all the raw edges of the outer pieces that are folded over the edges of the base pieces. You with me? You'll get what I mean once I actually get to doing it. So that's going to be the next step, and then I can actually start kind of getting the hats put together and start covering the base layers, and these should start looking like hats, which is always exciting. So it is much darker out than it was when we last talked, and I've been busy. So I went ahead and covered most of the panels. I've got 3 left to do over there, and I'm also missing one. So I guess I've done like 2/3, but basically I've just been taking the outer layer of fabric and pinning it and then sewing it to the base layer of material. So these aren't lined yet. I've just been focusing on the outer fabric. So for this one, the outer edge is bound with bias binding, then the inner edge, the material's turned inward, and the same will be done for the lining. So the raw edges are tucked away. And then this is the top of one of the hats, the inside, kind of the same thing going on for all of these. Also for this process, I've been using this waxed thread. I don't think I would use this for a lot of projects because I don't like the weight of it very much, but it's been really, really nice for sewing through the interfacing. Since it's quite nubby thanks to the glue on it, that's also why I have tape on my fingers, so when I'm hand sewing, I'm not brushing my hand against it. The thread can be really prone to catching and knotting up, so I found that this has prevented any of that from happening. It's been pretty awesome. I still have these ones to finish, as I said. This one I'm gonna have to line with something because there are pencil marks on the top of the hat that are showing through the light color fabric that I'm using for that one. And then, as I said, I'm missing a piece. The top for hat D for some reason is missing, so I have to recut the base layer for that and sew wire into it, which is kind of annoying because I put everything relating to that away, but I guess it has to be done. And then I have these two pieces left to finish, but then I'm going to go ahead and pin lining into all of the pieces. So the lining fabrics are complementary or contrasting material depending on the hat, and I've just turned the necessary edges inward. So I used chalk to mark a line either 1 inch or 1.5 inches away from the edge, and then I clipped the curves and I ironed the raw edges so they touch that line, creating an even 3/4 inch or 1/2 inch allowance depending on where it's going. For example, on the inner edges of the brims, I'm using a 1/2 inch allowance because I have to notch the edge to turn it inward, and I want my lining to get very, very close to the edge. But for something like this, where I don't have to notch the fabric, it looks much nicer if the lining is like an even 1/4 inch away from the edge. So that's what I'm going for in certain hats. It just depends on the hat. And I'm hoping to get all of the lining sewn in while watching Mrs. Maisel. The first season came out yesterday, and I'm really excited because I'm actually in one of the episodes. They film in New York City, and they're advertising like crazy for people in their 20s to play extras. I applied and I ended up getting to be part of a club scene, which was really, really cool. You can actually see me in the scene too. It's at the very end of episode one. I'll insert a screenshot here. You mostly see the back of my head and I'm kind of hidden behind a pole for most of it, but it's a really cool experience getting to be there, and it's kind of cool that I'm actually in the episode too. So I just recut out and then sewed wire into the piece that I managed to lose. So now that's ready to be covered and lined. I also got all of these pieces completely covered, or at least the front sides of them covered. So now I just need to stitch in lining, which will take me a while because there are a lot of pieces here. This is the only piece I'm not going to get lined tonight, I don't think. Since it's white, I don't want to work on it downstairs, and I still have to cut out a lining for it. Then the actual lining for the hat are strips that are gathered down, so it's just a little bit more complicated. It's also a lot larger than the other pieces, so I'd rather focus on this when I'm upstairs, whereas the other stuff I think I can work on and hand sew in front of the TV. So those are my plans for tonight, and hopefully I'll be back to update you before the end of the evening, but I really have no idea how long lining the hats was going to take me.
It is now the next morning. I spent all of yesterday evening and a good bit of this morning getting the lining sewn to all of the hats. So now that is completely finished. I also have one of the hats, which is the pillbox hat, so the simplest one, completely done, short of trimmings. I also cut out the lining for the outer layer of fabric and then sewed the outer layer of fabric to the largest hat, and I also sewed in the ruched lining. I made good progress. I just didn't finish 4 hats, and I think I can look back on this moment and realize that thinking I could finish 4 hats in a day and a half might have been slightly ambitious. I don't want to push off posting this video any longer, so I think I just have to cut it here and acknowledge that you're not going to see finished hats in this video. But maybe that will encourage you to subscribe and stick around because you want to see how the hats turn out in the next progress Logmas, which will be coming out next week. But before I officially sign off, I want to show you around the sewing room and show you what I managed to get done yesterday and what I managed to get done this week in general.
So over here I have the hat parts. These are the crowns. So the next step for these is overlapping the back edges. I can't do this with one hand by 1 inch, so they take on the shape of a crown, and then the tops of the hats will be sewn to the crown of the hat. And before I can sew the crown and the top of the hat onto the brim, I have to bind the edges of the brim. So all of these were constructed in such a way that the inner edge is finished by folding the edges inward and slip stitching them together. But the outer edges are left completely raw because they're finished with bias binding. So I have to sew the bias binding onto the outer edge of all the brims and then fold that inward and stitch it down by hand. And then the tops and the crowns can be stitched on, and then I can trim them, which is my favorite part. And by trimming them, I don't mean like cutting them, I mean like adding feathers and flowers and stuff to them. So that's like the light at the end of the tunnel pushing me and my poor sore fingers forward and trying to get these done. But as I said, I just don't think it's going to happen today. Since these are a commission project, I want to make them really nicely. So even if I could finish them today, I think the quality of work on them would suffer, and I don't want that to happen. So I'm setting these aside for now, and I will come back to them tomorrow and try and document the remaining process of getting them finished for all of you guys. I also have this set of stays, and I just sewed eyelets into the fronts. Lots of eyelets. Like 30 something eyelets, but I think they turned out pretty well, even though I'm a little bit out of practice when it comes to sewing eyelets. So yeah, those are the stays. I haven't tried them on yet. I'm a little bit scared to try them on. I feel like they might be too big and the silhouette might not be quite right, which is part of the reason I've left this back seam unfinished. So it'll be easier if I have to take boning out and take them in at this point. But let's hope that doesn't happen. Let's hope that they look absolutely fabulous once I get them on. Speaking of absolutely fabulous, over here I have the beginnings of the Regency bodice, which is going to be one of my Christmassy projects this year. I still have to sew the remaining sleeve on, putting that off for as long as I can because I hate sleeves. And then over here we have the 1630s bodice, which doesn't look very impressive given how much time I've invested into this, but I think it's going to look quite pretty once it's finished. So in the coming week I'll be working on the skirt for this and trying to get it finished so I can start on the cape that goes over top of it, which is the same sort of situation I have with this project. Filming the process of making the dress, and then the cape is going to get its own devoted vlog. Or at least that's what I'm kind of thinking right now.
So that is the state of what I've been working on this week, or you know, what we've been working on. Though to be honest, you haven't been entirely helpful in the construction process in the sewing room this week. I do appreciate the delayed moral support that you are giving me by watching this. And on that note, thank you so much for taking the time to watch this. I realize this was a doozy of a video and it didn't have a ton of sewing content in it. I'm kind of sad that this is the video I'm coming back with because I know I'm capable of better, more interesting content, but I have filmed so many videos and then not posted them over the past couple of months just because I haven't felt they're a good enough video to return with, and I think I just have to suck it up and post what I filmed and hope that you guys enjoy it and acknowledge that I can make better videos in the future. That ramble is basically me just begging you not to unsubscribe because of this. In fact, if you could subscribe to see that better content in the future, that would be fantastic. And I think that is enough rambling for today. Thanks again for watching and thank you for your support just in general. A special extra shout out goes to my patrons whose credits I will be sharing in the next video. And that's it for me for now. I will talk to all of you with more content very soon.